And good evening from Houston, where the clear skies above us are deceiving and conditions remain very dangerous in many places throughout this region. The rain might have moved out from Houston, but this remains very much an unfolding crisis. Rescues have been happening every minute of every hour by boat and increasingly by helicopter, especially in Beaumont and Port Arthur, which is east of here in Houston, hammered by what used to be Hurricane Harvey as it made second landfall overnight along the Texas-Louisiana border. Naval aviators, Army and Coast Guard choppers have all been flying, often in very risky conditions, and they are pulling people to safety. It is not over yet. Port Arthur's mayor says the entire city is underwater. It is much the same, we're told, in Beaumont. Water clear to the horizon. I just want to show you a picture that pretty much says it all. It only looks like a storm-tossed bay that you're looking at until you see that interstate road sign. This body of water south of Beaumont is not a bay, it's a stretch of I-10. Logan Wheat, who snapped that photo, also shot video of this from the small boat he was in, which is the only way to get around and in around much of the Beaumont-Port Arthur area. And this was not taken, by the way, as Harvey came ashore on Friday. It was taken last night when it struck the second time. Not over yet by any means. Here in Houston, water still covers entire neighborhoods across this enormous city, block after block, mile after mile, still underwater. Not over yet. And I want to show you a live shot you're looking at right now. It gives you just a sense of, this is in Houston, just a sense of how big this is and how many the kind of flooding we are still seeing in neighborhood. This is by the Attix Reservoir, one of the two reservoirs that areas around them had not flooded until more recently when water began to come out of that reservoir. They had to release some water so that to relieve some of the flooding in that area. Gives you just one sense of one neighborhood. Behind me, there's members of the Texas State Marine Unit who have been undertaking rescues all day in this area of Houston where I am. You see them now. Their work is done for the day. They've stopped because it's starting to get dark. They're probably going to resume here tomorrow as well. They say they have taken out as many as 600 people, 610 people, and it wasn't just them. There's an army of volunteers, people who, I talked to one young man earlier today who actually just bought a boat 2 days ago because he wanted to come here, didn't live here, but he bought a boat, he drove it here, and he has been helping bring people out of their homes. The images just keep coming, along with some of the horror stories as well. We have seniors trapped, some for 24 hours, according to CNN's Drew Griffin, in the flood waters, shelters flooding, others filled to capacity, the death toll rising now at 28. But I mean, the truth is, there's no way to really get an accurate sense of how many people may have been hurt in this, how many people are still missing, and how many people may have died. I was talking to the sheriff of Harris County, who said it's going to take a lot of time until the floodwaters dissipate that they can really get a sense of the toll. The grim work of recovery soon to get underway around us, but still days in the future across other parts of the region. It is not over yet. Luckily, neither is the truly remarkable outpouring of volunteers that we talked about. Their flotilla of small boats and big trucks. Ordinary people just doing extraordinary work at a time of such great need. Joining us right now by phone is Becky Ames. She's the mayor of Beaumont, Texas. Mayor Ames, I appreciate you've been with us. I'm sorry it's under these circumstances. This morning you said that every single body of water around you was at capacity and overflowing. What's the situation right now where you are?
Well, it is still that way. Unfortunately, sometimes when we're near bodies of water like the bayous and the rivers that we have so many around Beaumont, the aftermath is worse because when they crest, some of the flooding starts then. I don't believe we're quite as bad as Port Arthur. We have many homes that don't have any damage whatsoever, but then we do have homes that have some water in them. I don't have any that are totally covered that we're aware of yet.
Do you have any idea of how many of your residents still need to be rescued or maybe unaccounted for? I mean, do you have a sense, are you not at that stage yet?
Well, we are still assessing because what we are asking them to do, we have a customer service hotline that we've turned into a non-emergent call center where we have asked, it's 311, and we've asked the residents if they need to be rescued and it's not emergent, or if they think they might need to be rescued, that they call that 311, and we prioritize that. So I would expect that most of the people that are going to need help have called us, unless they are going to get hit later with the rising water supply or in the or that they live near the river. So we are prioritizing those. The non-emergent residents that maybe just can't get out of their homes for food, we are, like I said, prioritizing them. But also, when it gets dark, they do know that we wait until daybreak because of the standing water so much in the streets and the outlying areas and in the canals. It's very dangerous for them us to try to rescue them. But it certainly helped a lot when we had outdoor resources today. We stood up our emergency operations center on Wednesday, and we started getting heavy rains on Saturday night and Sunday. So we have been doing rescue efforts with just our first responders since Sunday. So we have been working on this for several days. We did have worse rain last night, as you know, but some of these residents were already rescued.
What do you have what you need? Do you need more boats, more high water trucks? I'm wondering what's your message to state and federal authorities right now?
Well, actually, they have been very responsive, and I'm sure there will be some things in the future. Right now, they have been extremely responsive. Our biggest issue right now is we don't typically shelter in Beaumont. So we've opened, we have three shelters open. They were not at capacity until they started getting at capacity today, so we're looking at opening another shelter. The issue is not the space. We have plenty of space, but a shelter you don't just put up there and ask people to come. As you know, you have to have supplies, cots, blankets, food,
sure,
and someone that really knows how to run it. And the Red Cross, because of all the devastation in Texas, is very, very spread thin, and our limited resources for them too. So I think that would be our biggest issue, the resources that we need to put into the new the secondary shelter that we're setting up, and then someone to actually run it. We partner typically with the Red Cross in helping, but we don't actually run shelters. But we will partner like with nursing and with helping with resources, but not actually running it. So that's probably the biggest challenge right now. I have been here for a life, and I've been the mayor for 10 years, and I've never seen us have this many people that needed shelter.
Well, we hope you're able to open up that other shelter, Mary Ames. I appreciate so much you taking the time to speak with us. I wish you and everybody.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I'm having a hard time hearing. Have already opened it. We just don't have all the resources we need to complete it, but we are getting them. We will not. No one has been turned away. No one.
That is certainly good news. Well, Mayor, I hope to speak to you tomorrow night as well, and I just wish you and the people there the best. As we mentioned at the top of the broadcast, the military has ramped up rescue operations. We have been watching a number of those all day. Two U.S. Navy warships, the USS Kearsarge and the USS Oak Hill, are being deployed to the area, along with 690 Marines, according to our Barbara Starr of the Pentagon. Medical, communications, other support teams are already in place or are on their way. CNN's Martin Savage has been out and airborne with Navy rescuers over East Texas. He's been capturing some remarkable images. He joins us now. So, Martin, you're still on the chopper returning to base. Tell us what you've been seeing up there.
Well, this one boat, the Navy version of the Black Hawk, spent about 3.5 to 4 hours working the area of Beaumont, of course, where you swamped in the mayor. What they were doing, they rescued 25 people, mostly women and children. And just to watch the drama of these people who have been really terrorized by what water rise all around them, and then eventually into their homes, see them airlifted into the helicopter. There is both fear on their faces, of course, being raised in the air, but the relief when they're on board. One woman just kept saying over and over to
Yeah, Martin, we're having trouble here. Martin, we're having trouble hearing you. So we're going to come back to you when we get contact. Maybe when you get back down on the ground, and we're going to next to Beaumont and CNN's Drew Griffin, who has been having quite a remarkable day as well. Drew, you've been on the ground all day. Talk about what you've been seeing there.
It's a violent night, and to add on to what the mayor was speaking to you about, Jefferson County, which is where Beaumont is, it's really a series of islands, Anderson. So you have these people rescued, they're put on an island, and then as water continues to rise, that island gets smaller, and those people need to be rescued off of that island, to another island, to another island. So that's why you have this day after day after day of rescue, and the water in some places is still rising in this county. We just heard about a levee breach that is flooding another subdivision just west of here. It can happen in a split second. That's exactly what we found out this morning. We're setting up for a live shot when all of a sudden we heard a noise and we found this guy in really dire straits. Take a look. Look at this. Get out, dude! You got it. You got a power cord? You got a rope? Hold on, I'm trying to get you a rope. All right, buddy, come on. Get up out of that water. No, don't fall backwards. You all right? No, ma'am. We got a car in a ditch. We just pulled a fellow out. Lord have mercy. Are you all right now, buddy?
Yeah.
All right, take your breath, and we're going to pick you up. We're going to want to get you off of this bank. Okay?
Just a second.
We're going to get you off of this bank. 66-year-old Jerry Sumrall, he was just out looking for food. He got in trouble. He's doing okay. We talked to him later, but this is the danger right now, Anderson. This water, this intersection was flooded just about an hour ago. In fact, the police are over there trying to deal with flooded cars that were just left here. But the water continues to move throughout the county, so it drains here. It's got to go somewhere else. People are not used to these areas being flooded, and they're getting in trouble, which is why right now this emergency is not only continuing for people who need to be evacuated, but for all the people who have been cooped up for days, want to get out and see something, and they find themselves getting in trouble just like that fellow did this morning. Anderson?
Well, Drew, that's one of the really deceptive things there is you can't tell, obviously, how deep this water is unless there's, you know, a submerged car that you just see the top of it or something. I mean, even in the area that we're in right now, if we just pan over here, you have no sense of how deep this water is. And it just goes on. It's really as far as the eye can see. I'm told, further down there, it gets up to about the waist. Here, it's pretty shallow. But, Drew, I assume that's what happened to that man who you helped rescue. He had no idea that the water he was driving into was going to be so deep.
Anderson, he thought he was driving onto a road. He had no idea that was a actual drainage ditch. It was a ditch that he was driving into. He thought he was just crossing a parking lot, crossing a road that was covered with water, and he was gone. It's floating. And just after we pulled him out, his truck, his four-wheel drive truck, sank. It happens that quick. People do not recognize the difference between standing water that's over road, standing water that is actually a raging river as a drainage ditch. And it's happening all across southeastern Texas right now.
The images you're seeing on your screen are from Orange, Texas. Those are the first images I'm seeing from that area. And again, you get a sense of just how much water there is on the ground. Drew, I appreciate that. That's near the border of Texas and Louisiana, I should point out. I want to get some perspective now from a pair of experts, CNN contributor and retired Army Lieutenant General Russell Honore, who, of course, headed up the Hurricane Katrina effort, and also joining us is John Connors, a former Marine and member of Team Rubicon, which is an organization that brings together veterans and first responders, volunteers for moments just like this. General Honore, first of all, what's your assessment of where things stand now in terms of rescue operations, in terms of the flooding?
Well, the problems got bigger. I mean, we now go from Carcass Christi to into Cameron Parish with search and rescue missions ongoing. And this is the hard part. After we do the initial picking people up with helicopters and using emergency signals to find people, once this water go down, Anderson, every house has to be checked. And that cannot be done by a civilian volunteer. Without these volunteers, we've really been in a mess because the military has been slow to scale up. I've spoken about that for 4 days now, that they should have been scaling up. We should have Navy ships follow hurricanes in. We learned that in Katrina. We learned that in Rita. One of the biggest hurricanes predicted as of last Thursday didn't have Navy ships following it. We've got to get this fixed because we're at the beginning of hurricane season. That being said, the shelters look great. Everybody is getting along as far as the government agencies. We don't have the bickering and the fighting. But
and the volunteer efforts, I got to say, are just incredible.
Yes, but I was here today with a boat. We came on this very road to go search. Nobody to talk to. Mm-hmm. No communication system. We need to tie that together with a disruptive technology mm-hmm. that allow the police and fire to talk to civilians right. that are coming into a region and say, go here. We're missing you over here. This is your mission. When you get there, link up with this, and then be able to communicate with
them. Yeah, John, from Team Rubicon, again, you guys are veterans, volunteers. You've worked in a lot of different areas. What are you seeing on the ground?
Yeah, so as you mentioned, we're a veterans-based disaster response organization. We pair our skills with first responders. So that means we're trained to respond to chaos, right? We're ready to go when this kind of thing happens. So our folks got on the ground on Monday, and we've been doing boat operations since Monday. We will continue to do those until, you know, the community doesn't need it anymore.
But you're really focused also on long-term.
Yes. So right now our teams are setting up for the long-term. We expect we're going to be here for a few months.
Wow.
What we generally do is wait for the waters to recede so it's safe for our volunteers to come in. And then we just start working on long-term operations where we can help the community get back on their feet.
Because that's the thing. I mean, General Honore, you know, obviously there's the adrenaline now for folks here. That lasts for a couple days. Yeah, it gets you through. But, you know, once the water recedes, there's the grim reality of recovery operations, rebuilding.
And there are things that the volunteers can't do. Now, the volunteers, the big mission is to come help people muck houses. Last year in Baton Rouge, Katrina, for years after the hurricane, volunteer groups came from all over the world. You see that over there, Anderson?
Mm-hmm.
That water that's turned, every one of those catch basins got to be cleaned before the next storm.
Mm-hmm.
Every drain, every culvert, every bridgehead between here and the Gulf is going to have to be cleaned. Because if it took 40 inches this time, next time it'll take 10, because what the impact the flood has had on the drainage system.
Is that, I mean, that's one of the things, is there's attention on storms when they happen and the immediate aftermath. And we saw this with Katrina. Yeah. We went back down to New Orleans, I don't know, 20 times or something yeah. over the years. But a lot of people, once the water dissipates, they kind of think, oh, it's over, but right. it's not.
Exactly, and Team Rubicon is still, to this day, working on houses in New York and New Jersey that were wrecked during Superstorm Sandy.
Mm.
So, you know, the everyone else forgets about it, but we're gonna stay there with the community until everyone gets back on their feet.
What do you see in terms of organization at this point?
You know, what our teams have been seeing every day is the armada of the community that has stepped up to help each other, and that's amazing to see. And to see everyone working side by side with the government agencies is really encouraging.
You exist, John, you exist, Team Rubicon exists basically from donations and not getting government funding. It's Team Rubicon, what's the website?
TeamRubiconUSA.org.
Okay, appreciate
Please.
You being
donations.
Here.
Donations.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Thanks very much.
Much.
All right, appreciate
12
it.
12 years ago today.
I know, it's crazy. I want to talk to you about that. Take a look at these live pictures again. What area is this now? Okay, this is Orange, Texas, and it just gives you a sense of, I mean, this thing is not over. I mean, I know a lot of folks saw Houston today. They saw the rain stopped and they thought, oh, you know, well, the worst is over. And that may be the case for some neighborhoods here in Houston. But check out what's happening right now in Orange, Texas. You get a sense of just how deep those waters are. When we come back, what began as a truly life-saving rescue, or resuscitation, in fact, has now turned into something of a mystery. No one seems to know for certain where this survivor now is. She apparently still needs medical attention. We'll have details on that next. We'll also hear from some of the survivors, even now, still making their way to safety with the help of an army and flotilla of volunteers we've been talking about. We'll be right back live from Houston and all along the region.
Anderson Cooper.
And welcome back. We're here in Houston. I just want to give you a sense of what's happening right behind me. This is the Texas State Maritime Unit, Division, excuse me. They were supposed to be stopped for the night, but someone just came up to them and said that their grandmother is in a house and needs to get out, needs some rescuing. So they're actually mounting up again. They're going to take out some of their boats out. They had stopped because it's starting to get dark, and they were going to resume tomorrow, but they look like they're going to go out to try to find that person. You can also see another boat just coming in right now if you just pan over here a little bit. I don't know if they're bringing somebody out or if this is just a boat that's returning after a day of rescues. Again, that looks like a group of volunteers. We have seen so many rescues just from this area today. More than 600 people, we were told, were brought out over the course of the day. And again, some of these folks are just volunteers. They had a boat, they brought the boat here. They're not even people necessarily who live in this neighborhood. So we're going to continue to follow what's going on here. We'll obviously bring you any updates. Now, if recent experience is any guide, there are going to be scenes like this unfolding around the area, rescues, whether by police, troops, or the volunteers from the area around the Gulf, as well as across the country. There's a lot to talk about. I want to go now to Ryan Nobles, who is in Orange, Texas. Ryan, we've been seeing some of the images from Orange tonight. What's happening there on the ground right now?
Yeah, Anderson, so Orange is just on the Louisiana-Texas border. So this is an area that was hit hard by the second wave of Harvey after it went back out to the Gulf of Mexico and then came back inland. So a lot of the flooding here began around 1 o'clock this morning. And you can see this area where we are now. This is a shopping market area. It's become kind of a central locating point. And you can see in the distance there, there is a supermarket. Now, we understand that supermarket is closed, but from time to time, they're getting in food and water shipments. And so there is a line of people out in front of this supermarket hoping to get stocked up on provisions so that they can take care of their families. And the rescue effort has gone on here all day, starting early in the morning and continued. Like what you're seeing in Houston, it is by and large a volunteer force. There are certainly first responders from both Louisiana and Texas helping to guide them. But one of the problems they had earlier today, Anderson, and even into the night, is that there are many boats willing to get people out of their homes and to dry land, but there aren't necessarily buses and cars and trucks able to take them to shelter. So that's one of the holdups now in this rescue effort, but it is going to take some time before all these people can be rescued and to be put in somewhere safe, and the water at this point has not started to recede. Anderson?
Ryan Nobles, appreciate it. As you heard just then, so many people in Houston and East Texas are wondering about their loved ones, whether they're okay, whether they're alive. And as you see behind me, these are some folks who are just being brought out. They're thanking the folks who brought them out. And also you have now this maritime division, which are going to start out. They've got helmets on. It may not seem like, this water is not particularly fast moving, but they have to take all the precautions they possibly can. Because some of that water is very deep, you get in some areas of eddies, it can turn bad very, very quickly. Many of those survivors who did escape the waters are still now looking for other ones. Many local survivors are now in the George R. Brown Convention Center in Houston. Houston Police Chief Art Acevedo is there now. He joins us. Chief, if you could just tell us what the latest is tonight in terms of rescue operations. Do you have a sense of how many people were rescued today? How many people do you still believe may be in need of help?
Well, I can tell you that the rescue operations have continued in our west area of the city, in the Memorial area, where we know the water has creeped up and continued to creep up. I don't have a current number. This is really day six for the Houston Police Department where our people haven't gone home. As a matter of fact, this will be the first time tonight that we're going to let some of them go home to get some rest. But the numbers are, every hour that passes, they're going down. And it's certainly, with the thousands of people that have been rescued, we're down to probably a matter of 100 or so.
I wonder, to the people, who see the waters receding and maybe think Houston is out of the woods, what is your message to those people tonight?
Well, first, the message is that we're not quite out of the woods, because we know that we still have a water event going on in our west side of the city, the Memorial City Mall area. And we still haven't gone into these neighborhoods to do our secondary searches. My heart's still aching, all of us fearful that we still might find more folks and homes in all these flooded out areas. Anderson, if you look at the destruction here, two-story homes completely engulfed and covered by water where you can't even see the rooftops. We just fear what we might find. And so while we're hopeful and we're glad we have had such few deaths in such an event of, biblical proportions because of the number of water we've had, we're still concerned about what we still might find in days to come.
And that actual toll, you may not know, is my understanding, until the waters recede, and as you said, until you can do those secondary searches.
Correct. And so that's, secondary searches are first responders. It's still very risky to go back into those neighborhoods where power lines are down and gas mains and everything else and a lot of debris, a lot of things that they have to deal with. And so we're thankful that there are additional strike teams with search and rescue capabilities. They're headed towards our area of operation here. And those strike teams are going to help us complete those secondary searches.
Yeah. Well, Chief, I wish you the best and all your officers. I appreciate it. Thank you so much for talking with us, Chief Acevedo.
Thank you.
Doing incredible work here in Houston. So much need. So many people to respond to. So many neighborhoods to try to cover. Up next, what you're seeing here is not a bay. Take a look at this video. It's an ocean, but it's not an ocean. It's actually the freeway. It looks like an ocean or a bay. We're going to talk to the man who took this video when we come back.
They took off two of them.
All right, welcome back. Things are moving very quickly, obviously, on the ground. I want you to meet Frankie Aziz, who just came over to this area. Now, these guys who have been out here all day rescuing people from this neighborhood, which is still very flooded, they were done for the night. Frankie, you got a call from your aunt.
My aunt, yes.
Explain what happened.
Everything was fine, settled with communication with them throughout the family. And all of a sudden this morning we had a call, you know, from there, like, well, there's water rising in there on their street.
And that hadn't happened until this morning in this area.
Until this morning. Right. And then we said, let me come and get you and all that. And then she was like, no, we're fine. We're just going to ride it, you know. We don't think it's going to be a big deal.
How old are your aunt and uncle?
My uncle is 90 and my aunt is like 83.
Okay.
Yeah, they're elder couple, right. Live in the house.
So they thought they saw the water coming, but they thought they could ride it out.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, about half an hour ago, I get a call from my aunt and she's like, we're stuck. Water is up to the house.
Wow.
We can't. We need help.
Uh-huh. And so you just drove over here.
I took off from the house. I lived by the gallery. It came out here. And I thought that, you know, we borrowed one of my friend's hired truck.
Uh-huh.
We thought that we were just going to drive into the neighborhood right. with a hired truck.
But the water's pretty deep.
You can't. Yeah. It's unbelievable.
So luckily these guys were still here.
Absolutely.
And they've agreed to go.
Yes. And I just gave them the information, the address and the location.
Uh-huh.
And then they just took off to of the Coast Guard.
And are you still in communication with
your aunt? Yes, I'm calling her. Yeah,
to let
I just talked to her like about a minute ago.
How are they holding up?
They're there. They're scared. It's getting to that point where it's like, you know, it's coming a matter of a life or death to them, and
right.
they're ready to come out.
That's the thing. I think for so many people woke up today, it wasn't raining.
Sunshine.
You know, the neighborhood hadn't really flooded.
Yeah.
But then as certain reservoirs start to flood and overflow, new neighborhoods start to flood that didn't flood before.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what happened here.
Yeah, it's going to like the opposite from where they were fine until everything calmed down from the storm and the rain, and now this whole entire...
You've been here since the early 90s. Have you ever seen anything like it? I mean, you lived
through
Rita, all the others.
Yeah, Ike, all of them, and never.
Yeah.
It flooded for a day or two, certain areas. Never seen where we have like a river.
Yeah.
You know. For the whole entire subdivision or the whole entire, you know, area, you know, it's covering up a large amount.
Well, Frank, man, I appreciate you talking to us, and I know you'll be staying here, and I just wish you the best for
thank
your
you. Thanks and for
your
all the help with the Coast Guard. Well, they're doing an amazing job.
They are.
Thank you
very
guys.
Much, Frankie Aziz. Thanks. Seen as Brian Todd, it's been all day out on the water. He joins us now. Brian, I mean, you've been out there. I've been watching you throughout the day, following rescue efforts in Houston, also obviously for days. What exactly are residents facing right now? What have you been seeing today?
Anderson, they're devastated and they're actually just trying to process this because they were taken by surprise with this wave of flooding that occurred, because it really just started in this neighborhood in earnest at about 1 a.m. in the morning this morning, overnight, after the brunt of the storm had passed. These people thought they had actually ridden it out without too much flooding, but that controlled release from the Attucks Reservoir, which flooded the Buffalo Bayou not far from here, was what really brought all these floodwaters on. And I'm in a high water vehicle now. I'm about 8 feet above ground. Just huge wheels on this pickup truck that we're riding in the back of here. But you can see behind me here just how deep the water is. We were on an airboat with some private rescuers earlier today, and we were just going around doing door knocks and, you know, watching for people flagging us, and several people did. By my estimation, we pulled probably 20 people out of these homes. And Anderson, look at this. This is there are apartments down there. It's a labyrinth of places. If you want to try to get out, the only way you're going to get out is with a high water vehicle like this one or some kind of an airboat. When we rescued those people earlier, we got a chance to talk to them, and this is what they were going through.
Some of the people now being rescued had thought they dodged a bullet.
Yesterday afternoon, the sun came out, it receded a little bit. We put everything back that we had put upstairs and And then we had a little hurricane party last night till about midnight. And at 1 o'clock, we had a foot of water.
See that towel tied on the...
Volunteers like airboat pilot Mark Malfa and his partner Joe Fairchild are out looking for victims to help, especially any place with a towel or other distress sign, in spite of the dangers and reports that two rescuers may be missing.
You think about the danger out here?
Not really. No.
Why not?
Just come and do it, you know? And I run a boat all the time. I deal with horrible crap on a consistent basis. And I'm used to it. I don't think twice about it. People need help, come help them.
And we talked to a lot of these people when they got out and got to safer ground, and I asked them, do they want to return to their neighborhoods? And some of them were conflicted. Some of them said they wanted to stay, but others said they were going to have to make an excruciating decision as to whether to return home to all of this. Anderson?
Brian, do you have a sense of exactly, how long these rescue teams plan on staying, or you know, how they're planning for the days ahead?
You know, a lot of the time, Anderson, they gauge it by how exhausted they are at the end of a given day. The rescue teams that we were with today, again, these are all private boat operators. They said that they planned on staying, but, one of the guys who operated the boat said he was just completely fried by the end of the day. So these guys kind of assess it on a day-by-day basis, but they do wake up the next morning and they seem to want to go out. So I think a lot of them are going to be here until these waters completely recede.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of people certainly who appreciate what they're doing, saving lives. Brian Todd, thank you very much. When we come back, we're going to hear from the man who shot this just incredible video on I-10. I-10 looks more like the open ocean. We'll be right back.
Together, we'll make America great again. Thank you.
Welcome back. We're waiting to see what happens. We just talked to a guy, Frankie Aziz, who's worried about his aunt and uncle. His aunt thought they could ride out the storm in this neighborhood as the water started to come up just this morning. They are an elderly couple. She just called him and said that we need help. So some boats have been launched by state authorities here in Texas to go and get the couple out of their home. So we're waiting for them to come back. With each passing day, we're seeing more and more images that people have taken on their own. And I want to show you this image that we've looked at several times tonight, but I want you to hear from the person who actually took this image. It's some video that was taken on I-10. You would never know it's I-10. You would never know this is a highway. I talked to the man who took this a short time ago. Listen. And I think for some people, the video is kind of hard to wrap your mind around. What we're seeing is the interstate just completely underwater, right?
Yes, sir. Big 7 foot of water.
7 foot. And how long did that go for? I mean, how far was that?
The stretch that we drove across with the boat was about 2 miles.
Wow, 2 miles with water that deep on the interstate.
Yes, sir. I mean, as you got closer to the interstate, it got a little shallower and a little shallower, but where we were out in the pasture and driving to the canals, it was 7 foot or more.
It's just incredible. Logan, I appreciate you you taking the time to talk to us. Thank you so much. Be safe.
Yes, sir. No problem.
That's Logan Wheat. The images are just extraordinary. There are now 28 people confirmed dead in the aftermath of Hurricane Harvey. 28 lives ended far too soon, each with families and neighbors and friends who right now are grappling with grief. Joining me now are two people in the midst of that pain. And I want you to meet Lindsay Jordan Gay and Roger Lee Jordan. They lost their dad, Reuben Jordan, who's a beloved high school track and football coach. Lindsay, I'm so sorry for your loss, and I appreciate you spending some time with us just to tell us. Can you tell me, when was the last time you spoke to your dad?
I actually spoke to my dad Saturday morning. I'm a physician. I had gone into work Saturday morning, checked on my patients, and got out around noon and spoke to him. And, you know, we all kind of thought Harvey had come and gone and there wasn't very much going on, and he was kind of just hanging at the house. He told me to be careful getting home, and that was the last time I talked to him.
And Roger, did you speak with him at all about the storm?
Yes, sir. I spoke to him Saturday night around 8:30, and we were just conversing about the Floyd Mayweather and Conor McGregor fight, just, you know, having casual father-son talk. trying to place a personal bet as to who we thought were going to win. And he had mentioned wanting to go out and see the fight at a local sports bar. And that was the last that I had spoken to him as well.
Lindsay, just tell me about your dad. What kind of a man was he?
My dad was an amazing man. He has been a coach in the League City area for 28 years. He's been a pillar of the community. He is now, prior to him retiring, he was teaching the kids of the kids that he taught when he first started at Clear Creek. We can't walk anywhere
incredible.
Without someone knowing him and talking to him. Yeah, yeah.
What a legacy that he's taught the kids of the kids. I understand his grandchildren also were the light of his life, and that he actually told you that you had done everything in his life that he had done everything in his life that he ever wanted to do after he was able to meet your son.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I have an 8-month-old, and my dad, for everyone that knows him, he's a big guy. He's a big guy, and he keeps a serious face. Most of the time, but with my son, he was a teddy bear. I personally never seen him like that, and he has enjoyed this 8 months with my son so much.
Roger, I know there's been a huge outpouring of support from your community. As you said, your dad was just beloved. What do you want people to know about him?
He was a very determined, caring, and nurturing soul. He was adamant on encouraging today's youth to be as great as they possibly could. He's a loving individual. He taught us to carry ourselves with class, with dignity, and show each and every one that we came across the utmost respect, and that will naturally return in our favor.
Wow. Roger and Lindsay, I'm just so sorry for your loss, and I know those words sound so hollow in your grief, but we're thinking about you, and I wish you you both the best. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
12 years ago tonight, all eyes were on the city of New Orleans. It's hard to believe it's been 12 years ago. It was the day after Hurricane Katrina hit. I'll speak with the mayor of New Orleans next. Local authorities say they've received as many as 70,000 calls for help over the last several days, and they have given so much answering those calls. One veteran police sergeant, Steve Perez, gave his life. The work is dangerous, and at times it can seem endless, even for the professionals who are trained for these kind of moments, which makes their effort and that of the volunteers that we've met worth taking note of again tonight. Randy Kay reports.
The Air National Guard in the midst of a dramatic rescue. On the other end of that rope line is a newborn baby. This other child from the same family was also rescued. It went on until the whole family was safely inside the chopper. They were let out on drier land. Strangers came together to rescue an elderly man trapped in his car. He was being swept away by floodwaters when the group quickly formed a human chain, stretching from dry land to the man's car. The car appeared to be sinking fast, and rescuers yelled to those closest to the man to bust the window. They finally got the door open and the man out. He was taken to a local hospital and reunited with his son. A human chain would also help save the life of Annie Smith and her soon-to-be born baby. She was 9 months pregnant, going into labor, and trapped in her Houston apartment. She and her husband, both doctors, had just moved to Houston last month and had never experienced a hurricane. They began to prepare for a home birth, boiling water, and sterilizing equipment. Then they sent out an alert in their apartment complex, calling for an OBGYN. Strangers, some with medical backgrounds, came running. One quick-thinking neighbor stopped a dump truck outside. Neighbors formed a line holding hands so Annie could safely walk to the dump truck, which would take her to the hospital. One neighbor posted this video on Instagram, writing, "My incredible neighbors made a human chain to help the woman and her husband to the truck. Moments like these are incredibly precious and remind me of all the good in the world. The couple's daughter was born hours later in a real delivery room. There were countless rescues by boat, too. And when a boat wasn't handy, there was a cowboy on horseback.
This is what we do. We help livestock.
This man and his son set out to rescue horses, posting this video on Facebook.
He can come out now, son. Go ahead and careful with him.
He later posted, "We were able to swim in and save four of these horses today. One of the greatest feelings in the world is having my best partner by my side, my 17-year-old son. In a storm this bad, every rescue counts." Randy Kay, CNN, New York.
Incredible images. For some people right now, it may be hard to have hope here in Houston or in Beaumont or in Port Arthur tonight, which is seeing a lot of water on the ground, a lot of that city, Port Arthur, submerged. 12 years ago yesterday, Hurricane Katrina made landfall. And I wanted to talk to the mayor of the great city of New Orleans, Mitch Landrieu, who joins me now. Mayor Landrieu, you've helped bring New Orleans back from the brink. You've helped make New Orleans the extraordinary city that it is now. As you see what's happening here in Houston, as you see what's happening elsewhere in Louisiana and you know, in Beaumont and in Port Arthur, what goes through your mind tonight?
It's just really unbelievable. You know, those images are just, they're hard to watch for us, actually. You know, you interviewed me 12 years ago, and it was just incredible to watch these individuals go through what we went through. For those of us that were in the water helping people out, you know, you saw the most unbelievable tragedies that you can imagine. Yet at the same time, miraculously, you saw people who just would walk across the street from other people normally helping each other out. And then it just lifted your spirit about our capacity to help each other in the darkest hours. And so even though it's hard to watch, you're witnessing this in real time, how human beings can really rise above all the differences that we have and reach down and lift each other up. And it's just incredible. Painful, but incredible.
And it is, I mean, rebuilding is possible. I mean, for New Orleans, it took, I mean, obviously a lot of help from the federal government, a lot of help from the state, but also incredible volunteer efforts by churches, by veterans, by school kids, by college students,
yeah.
Just people coming for years and years and years.
Well, I would just say a couple of things to the people of Houston and Port Arthur and Beaumont and Lake Charles. I know it's hard right now, and I know it's painful. I know you're scared, I know you're frustrated, I know you feel like you lost everything. But there's going to be light out at the end of the tunnel. You can actually see it happening as you speak. And the truth of the matter is, New Orleans could have never come back on our own. We relied on the great help of the federal government, but the faith-based community, not-for-profits, kids from all over America came and helped lift us back up. And essentially, that's where you get the great hope for our country. You know we're going to survive because of what you're actually seeing on the ground right now, as tragic as it is, and it's going to be okay. And the one lesson that we learned that really transcended everything else is that in our darkest hours, we're all in the same boat. We're all the same. And it's just an amazing thing to be a part of. It hurts, but at the end of it, there's a rainbow, and it's going to get better.
What is, I mean, as you see the rescue efforts that have been underway here, what is the key to, what is the next step for Houston, for Port Arthur, for Beaumont, for all the communities that are so badly affected?
There are a couple of things going on right now that are unbelievable. 28 USAR teams have been dispatched by FEMA. That's the largest in the history of the country. The governor actually created a dual commandership, and so that NORTHCOM now, military assets, are helping. So there's a rescue effort going on that you can see. There's also a lot of folks that are in shelters. I think there are 146 shelters that are open, and some upwards of 22,000 people. The last statistic I heard was that 100,000 homes were hurt. So what's got to happen is people have to get back to normal as quickly as possible, but they may not be able to go as quickly as they want. And so those shelters have to stay in front of, if you will, the storm. Unfortunately, there are a lot of electrical outages, but if they can get electricity back, get that water down, start to pick up that debris, then everybody will start to lift everybody else up. One of the keys for us was getting the schools back open as quickly as possible and then trying to help people clean out their homes. And then what happens is you create a virtuous cycle. But here's the thing, the cameras are going to leave and the hard work is going to just be starting. And you just have to remember, put one foot in front of the next, love your neighbor, help each other up. And at the end of the day, it's going to get better, but it's not going to be easy. And I think everybody understands that and knows that. But Houston's strong, Texas is strong, and the rest of the country is going to be there for them like they were for us. No doubt about it.
Well, that's the thing. Houston was a city which opened its arms to a lot of folks from New Orleans, who got on buses and ended up here.
I tell you, Addison, it was unbelievable. I saw a story today about Mayor Bill White, who had to get evacuated. He was the mayor of Houston at the time that opened up the entire city for us with the county judges. And then he had to get rescued this week. It was heartbreaking for me to watch him walking out of that water. He was a giant when the recovery happened. And all of the people of Houston were. They received the people from New Orleans. They opened up their schools to us. They opened up our homes. We want to do the same thing for Houston if the need arises. We're hosting the LSU-BYU game this weekend, and we'll do anything that we can to help. I just think right now it's hard. You got to let the USAR teams do their work. You have to let all the experts in the shelters work with the individuals that are there, help them work through their pain. But you can just imagine how scared everybody is who thinks they lost everything and they can't see tomorrow. But at the end of the day, though, they'll be able to stand back up. And I know that the whole world and the country is going to help.
Well, I know you just marked, obviously, the 12th anniversary. More than 1,800 people lost their lives in Katrina. There's a beautiful memorial to them in New Orleans. My thoughts were with the great people in New Orleans yesterday on that terrible anniversary. I appreciate it, Mayor, you being with us tonight.
Well, thank you so much, Anna. Thank you for all the work that y'all are doing.
Well, take care. We'll see you soon. We're going to take a short break. We'll have more from Houston. Oh, actually, sorry. We're actually going to go to Chris Cuomo. Ryan Nobles is standing by in Orange, Texas. Let's check with Ryan. Ryan?
It's okay. You can call me Chris Cuomo. That's an honor to be called Chris Cuomo. That's all right, Anderson. And we are here in Orange, Texas, which is right on the Texas-Louisiana border. And the rescue effort here is ongoing. In many of these communities, water is as much as 4 feet up in some of these houses, and they really weren't expecting it. This is not a town that traditionally sees a lot of flooding. So we were in one neighborhood that's about a mile down the road from where we are right now. And I talked to a grandfather who said that the water started seeping in at around 1 o'clock this morning, and he just did not expect it. He got his family up. He had several of his grandkids that were staying with him in the house, and they started the process of trying to evacuate. He had a jet ski, but that wasn't enough to get everybody out. But that wasn't much longer into the day that the Cajun Navy came through, and there were boat after boat going through these neighborhoods and getting people to safety. That continues tonight. There is a shopping center that's here behind me that market itself is actually closed right now, but they've been getting in supplies of provisions, water, and food. They've actually been giving it out free to people that can get here, and there's been a steady stream of trucks pulling boats. We've seen National Guard come through with the high water trucks trying to get people into safe areas. The one concern that we've found is that they can get people out of their homes, they can get them to dry land, but getting them to shelters has been a bit of a problem because they haven't had enough buses and cars to get these folks to. So this is just the beginning of what is going to be a long recovery for the folks here in Orange, Texas. Anderson, back to you.
Ryan Nobles, you stay safe out there. Just want to show you, one boat has come back, but we're still waiting for that boat. A young man named Frankie Aziz came earlier, told some of the rescuers who had actually stopped for the night that his aunt had just called him. She's elderly. She's with his uncle, who's in his 90s as well, saying that the water had risen faster and much higher than they had anticipated in their home just today, and they need help. So a group of rescuers went out. We're still waiting for them to come back in. We'll try to bring you the results of that when they do come back. Chris Cuomo is going to take over our coverage now. I'm going to be back also at 11 p.m. Eastern Time live from here to bring you all of the latest. But right now, let's go to Chris Cuomo primetime.